You are listening to Toronto's only pure metal show, The Red Switch.
As unpatriotic as this is, I would say that Canada has been the highlight so far. There's a lot of places that we have never been before here in Canada. We've only been to a few select cities, I think Montreal and Toronto and a few other places, but not nearly as extensively as Bodom has done and how this tour is going. So even these kids have never, maybe they've heard of us before or anything, but we've not been to their town, so, you know, they've not been able to experience our band, I guess. So the response that we've gotten from, you know, essentially virgin crowds has been pretty phenomenal. There's a lot of kids there before we even start. On other bigger tours that we've opened before, you know, the place might be half full because, they, you know, nobody cares about the opening bands. But with this one, it's been great, you know. The venue is nearly full when the first band is playing. It's pretty excellent. I commend the Canadian fans.
Right. Now, the new album, from what I'm hearing, is particularly brutal. Tell me what the writing process was like how you guys collaborated.
Well, we have always had a kind of one way we write stuff. Nate, the big Viking guitar player, comes up with most of the stuff, and he has a little basic studio setup that has like his four-track, a drum machine, and he comes up with the kind of skeleton of a song, and then he'll send it to everybody, and then Scott, our other guitar player, might come up with some solos, or like, oh, what about this lead here, or just, you know, kind of, I think Scott always says that Nate's the cook, but we throw the ingredients in. I'm glad to hear that people think it's more brutal this time. I guess that's a good thing. There's not a whole lot of science going on, you know, or
a technical aspect.
Yeah, like, oh, this needs to be like this, and this measure here needs to be two BPMs faster or whatever. It's just kind of like, well, this is what we do, this is what we like, and
all right,
that's how it works.
Once in a while, there's like melodic elements I'm noticing. Is that something you're trying to drive more with this record? Like, what specific direction did you guys want to take?
Well, on our previous recordings, I think there's a lot more melodic stuff, especially sort of like happy melodic or epic melodic, I don't know, and Iron Maiden-esque type things, like harmonies and things of that nature. And although, like I said before, we don't really have a scientific, quote-unquote, writing process, we ended up kind of shying away from the happy-sounding stuff. There's still some a good amount of melody in it, I think, but it's shifted gears a little bit and not quite as, I don't know, poppy, I guess, but I don't know if poppy is the right word. I don't want to offend anybody, because I don't think we hold any of those types of melodic elements in disregard, but it's just not how it ended up this time. I think they're just a little darker and a little, I guess, just abnormal. And
the cool thing is when, you know, there's a lot of like chug heavy riffage going on, and then all of a sudden you just kind of like transition into that melodic part, whatever it happens to be, whether it's epic, and it's a nice change in song. So it's not just like, you know, all one.
Well,
kind of.
Thank you. I like those parts as well too. There's sometimes when I'll be learning the songs at home or writing parts or whatever, and I'll be sitting there in the little practice space I have, and I find myself like sitting there headbanging because I'm so excited about it. But I like that too. I mean, that's all Nate. I think that he's really got an ability for that, taking parts and, you know, just seamlessly sticking them together. And I like having a variation in the song, and our songs are usually not very like verse, chorus, A, B, repeaty.
Yeah.
Just having kind of like a tumult of riffs coming at you with, you know, like, and then a good part, like a really memorable part kind of rises up out of that, I think is cool.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm glad that you and other people hopefully have recognized that, and I think that's cool, I think.
Remains of the Defeated is the one where I thought it was like the best transition.
Oh yeah?
And it goes from, it's a pretty big section from one to the other. I don't know, I found it kind of cool.
Thank you.
Okay, so I remember a while ago you put out two self-release pieces of awesomeness before Setting Sail with Prosthetic. I'm wondering, what was it like in the earlier days? Like, was it a struggle for you guys with financial contributions, that kind of thing?
Well, I think we've been particularly lucky as far as finances go. We've always, not always, but pretty much even from the beginning, done well enough to not have to, I mean, we've all sunk our own personal money, but no one's ever gone broke playing in the band, which is, knock on wood, I count myself lucky. I don't think a lot of people get to do that. And that's not to say that we didn't work hard. I think we worked really hard in those endless amount of... I remember Scott used to have stacks and stacks and stacks of mailers where he was just sending out all kinds of stuff, whether it was press stuff to get gigs or CDs to get reviews and anything like that. And then that on top of, you know, we had to get the artists, we had to book the studio time, we would book the tours. And it's just a lot on a couple of individuals' shoulders. And back then we really, you know, didn't really know the hang of it. We just kind of jumped into the deep end and were like, well, this is what we're going to do, and just tried to approach it what seemed to be the best way for us to do it. And it was a struggle. And, you know, the first couple tours we went on, I remember we would sell maybe $100 in t-shirts and think it was the most amazing thing we had ever done. Not seem like an achievement, but, you know, when you're a local band and then you start to get some people interested in you around in your scene, then in the scene in your state, and then use that sort of momentum to get the confidence to go and play in other places. So to go somewhere you've never even been to before, maybe even personally, like, you know, having gone there on vacation, whatever, and be able to play those places is, and achieve anything is cool. But, you know, there's some kicks in the ass along the way, but you just got to remember that it's not all bad, and it's not always going to be good.
That's a good segue, because I'm wondering, like, what is the local scene like in Athens, Ohio?
Well, it's a college town of about 20,000 permanent residents and 20,000 students. It kind of, as far as the metal scene, there's always been a hardcore group through permanent residents and students kind of coming together. There's a couple of organizations, like ACRN, which is like a local college radio thing, always has a metal show, and there's a venue that has metal shows there. But since it's a college town, there's always all sorts of things, you know. Mm-hmm. There's all, you could go down the street, and that's like, I think, like 30 or 40 bars in like a two-block area. So you could go down the street and see a bluegrass band or whatever, or go down the street and see some kind of hip-hop thing. So there's, I think, a pretty vibrant music scene, and depending on like what generation of students it is, there's a stronger or weaker metal scene, but it's always been there. And there's always a good punk scene and sort of like DIY hardcore. For a couple of years, there was a pretty, I mean, pretty big on the scale of Athens. There was, you know, like maybe 400 or 500 people there, but there was a punk and hardcore and metal festival called For Real Fest that one of my friends put on, and it did well, and it got people out from the surrounding areas and stuff. So I think it's cool. I'm proud to call Athens my home. It's a really nice place, and we owe a lot to that scene and the Union Bar and Grill, where we start playing our first shows, and we always have our record releases and stuff there. That's where we play when we play in Ohio.